Okay, that is why you have the word Shashanka. You know the meaning of Shashanka?
Ate something.
Huh?
Ate something.
No. See, we have Shasha and Anka. See, these are the two words which form a compound Shashanka. Okay? So, Anka is a mark, as I said. Shasha.
Rabbit.
One can think of rabbit in the moon. So that is why we have the name. So the one who has its mark. That is the word Shashanka means. So that is why it. In fact, we have Dinanka, the most common example. So the day, every day sunrise or sunsets. Number. Okay? That is why we call it as a Dinanka. So Anka. Okay? So that which. So I just want tell you that even in, okay, so one finds the powers of 10 listed. Okay. So while offering your worship, you say I offer 1 times, I offer 10 times, I offer 100 times, I offer 1000 times. Okay, so somewhere it is mentioned. Okay, sakritte agne namaha dhiste namaha dashakritvaste namaha shatakritvaste namaha asasakritvaste namaha etc. So this occurs in Krishna Yajurveda. One also finds something in Vajasaneyi Samhita. So I didn't want to list the shloka. So there are all the powers starting from 10 to the power of 0 to 10 to the power of 12. So here the point to be noted is specific term for each power of 10 up to 10 power billion has been. So we say 10 million. So 10 million does not have a name. So we have million, billion, trillion and so on. So here they have given names. And I will not get into the details of how the names came because it will consume time, but I just wanted to tell you that. In the other tradition also, in the Egyptian system also, one finds this, but what one finds missing is the crucial concept of place value is missing. Okay? So anyway, so to represent 7000, so they have to put the mark 7 times. Okay? So suppose you use lotus to refer to 1000, you have to write draw 7 lotuses. So then it means 7000. So it is not just writing something. This is one difference. And in fact, it has been beautifully said. So this the importance of the creation of zero mark can never be exaggerated. This is an interesting phrase, okay? Which comes from Midsummer's Night Dream. Okay? So Shakespeare's play, Airy Nothing, okay? So, not merely a local habitation and a name, a picture, a symbol, but helpful power is the characteristic of Hindu race whence it sprang. Okay? So, from where it came. So, no single mathematical creation has been more potent for the general ongo of intelligence and power. Okay? So, then this the word which is associated with the zero is Shunya. Generally Shunya and Tamilians are there here? Tamilians?
Varsha.
What is the name for zero? Hindi mein Shunya bolenge. Any other Indian language? Yes to no? Sunna. Sunna is a derivative of Shunya. Pujya. So I was curious to know why is it called Pujyam. Pujyam means highly respectable, right? In fact, zero is insignificant. Okay, so the puzzle is zero, Pujyam. In fact, in other language also I think one has this Pujyam. So Pujyam means highly revered, etc. Okay, so he is a Pujya. Param Pujya we say, no? Param Pujya. So this Pujya means highly. So when zero divides, what happens? So anyway, so it is this is a very interesting thing. So I don't want to delve on into that. So that is a observation which I wanted to say. And the word the Shunya became cipher and then cifra and then cipher. So zero is and cipher. And Shunya, I just wanted to make this remark that they have different connotations. Okay? So why I say this is, so the concept has been there not only in mathematics, but in other disciplines as well. In fact, so it has its origin in philosophy. Okay? So the Buddhist philosophy, etc., the concept of shunya plays an interesting role, and this approaching zero is what they have this concept of anu. Okay? So they are all sort of related, and I will just show where this occurs in other disciplines. So shunya has an analogous concept with lopa in, see, jana shunya, when you say, means nobody was there, right? Absence of something. So this lopa, missing, okay? So something which is disappearing, something which is missing, something which is absent, so they are all, so the void, okay, the notion of void, so later turned into the number zero. So here in Paninis, so we have this interesting lopa coming into picture in various things in an abstract way, and in a more concrete way, I would say, along with the symbol, it appears in Pingala's Chandas Sutra. Chandas Sutra is one of the six branches. Chandas is one of the six branches of Vedanga. Okay, so there you have the word Rupe Shunyam. Okay, so how to mark? Okay, in fact, it is a lot of combinatorics is there in Pingala's Chandas Sutra. So I would say that a very comprehensive article has appeared. Okay, so on this combinatorics in Pingala's Chandas Sutra in one of the recent publications. Okay, so by Hindustan Book Agency. So Rupe Shunyam is the sutra, and Fritz Stahl has written an article, The Origins of Zero. As I said earlier, this is a contested thing. Okay? So different people, so no, it had its origin there, it had its origin there. So we are not too much bothered about that. But then an article, so primarily The Origins of Zero, that is the title of the article. So there Fritz Stahl concludes, I conclude that ancient India reverberated with zeros. So he says reverberated in zeros because in various disciplines you find. So whether it is grammar, whether it is Chandas Shastra, whether it is Shrauta ritual, whether it is philosophy, you take Buddhism, you take Jainism, so the various things. So it occurs in various contexts, and therefore he says ancient India. So by that he means in the Vedic age, okay, reverberated with zeros, zero entities and zero events long before the geometry of Shulva Sutra. Okay? I can tell thus far two conditions must be satisfied before a concept of zero may arise. One, there needs to be a language as well as another formal structure, so in which, so in this it goes on. Okay? So this is something which must. Okay. I move on to a different topic. So this is indeterminate analysis. By indeterminate analysis I mean, so you have an equation, so you have one equation and there are two variables. So how do you solve that? Okay, this is what I mean by. So if it is a first order, suppose you have an equation of the form, so let us say ax minus by is equal to c, a, b, c are given constants, and x and y have to be determined. This is not a trivial problem. Okay? So this is called indeterminate equation of the first order because the variables appear in first degree. So we have indeterminate equation of second order, dx square plus 1 is equal to y square. Okay? So these are problems which have been handled by Indian mathematicians. And in fact, so since Manjul Bhargava was referred repeatedly here, I must tell you that once Manjul was sharing with me that he drew inspiration, okay, to solve certain problems, so which got him all the fame that he has today. So from this Brahmagupta's work, see, Brahmagupta's work unfortunately has not been studied till date. Brahmagupta lived around 650 AD. In fact, not even a good edition of this text is available till date. It is a very sad story, and I don't know whether one can get even manuscripts to do this. So it is a very difficult task. There is hardly one or two manuscripts as I understand today, and the edition which is available is abysmal, and this is true of certain other things also, but it is a little difficult situation, so we have to see something can be done to save what is remaining. So this is an interesting thing. So which has been solved by Indian astronomers, and there was a need for that. So what I want to say was, the need was basically, as I said, so there were problems in astronomy where you had to fix certain things. So you know certain numbers, you have to fix certain other numbers, and the numbers have to be integers. The numbers have to be integers, for instance the number of evolutions of planets, etc. So if you want to find out, so it is in this context they had to find solutions to these problems, and that is what they did. And so this equation, so if you find large numbers for x and y, then it will be a good approximation to root d also, okay. So finding, so that is also another. So when you look at how the situation was elsewhere with regard to solving indeterminate equations, so what one understands is, so it started only around 17th century in Europe. On the other hand, this indeterminate equation of first order was solved by Aryabhata, so in 5th century. So Batchet, okay, so was the first person, so to have solve this equation. So this is what, in 1654, and later of course it got developed very seriously, okay, in a very detailed manner by various people, okay, Euler, Lagrange, Bernoulli, all that. So there is an interesting citation. So Fermat, so he is considered to be the father of number theory, so he writes a letter in 1657. I propose the following theorem to be proved. What is to be proved? Or a problem to be solved. Basically he is saying this, okay. So dx square plus 1 is equal to y square. So this was solved completely by Brahmagupta in 650. And he says, it is just to know, okay. So given any number, whatever which is not a square, which means he refers to d, so d is not a square number, there are also given an infinite number of squares, okay, so which he means x square, such that if this square is multiplied into the given number and unity is added to the product, the result is a square. So this he chose as a very challenging problem, so in 1650s, okay. And Andre Weil, he says, what would have been Fermat's astonishment if some missionary just back from India had told him that this problem had been successfully tackled there by native mathematicians almost 6 centuries before. So why does he say 6 centuries before? So Brahmagupta did not give a complete solution, but this complete solution was given little later. Of course he gave a very important principle. Brahmagupta's contribution is phenomenal. But later, about 4 centuries later, it was completely solved. Okay, this is called Chakravala method, so I will not get into the details. So, but I just want you to note this for some reason, okay. So, why it is usually called Pell's equation. Pell has nothing to do with that, okay. So, that is something which has been recognized by everyone, okay. So, that is why I just wanted to say, so Michael Ataya, one of the greatest mathematicians, he says, okay, so incorrectly as Pell's equation, okay. So that mistake was committed by Euler. In fact, Euler referred to as Pell's equation. That is why it is very important. Yatha raja tatha praja. Okay. If some established fellow comes and says something wrong, then everybody is believing that. That is how it just happened. Okay. So one is not to blame anyone, but I am just telling you that this is the truth. Okay. So to just give you a flavor as to what are the different kinds of topics that will be in a mathematics text, I just wanted to list this. So it will start with prakirna vyavahara, see, so day-to-day affairs. So if you want to purchase some vegetable, if you want to purchase some rice, you need to know weight, measure, all this, okay. So there will be some chapter on that. There will be mishra vyavahara, see, any economics, okay. So sales, partnership, interest, etc. There will be very interesting problems, I must tell you. So I'll just give you one or two examples. The problem which have been, so one of the reasons as to why people do not like mathematics is it is not presented interestingly. So we have to have some interesting problems. If one just presents something which is very abstract at the age of 5-6, so the student will necessarily have some aversion to the subject. And that aversion never ever goes. Okay. So in fact, when I have to teach some statistics to people who come from sociology background, So the pain that I undergo, God knows. So however much you say that you have to drop this phobia, they will never drop phobia because it is permanently set into their mind. Okay. So anyway, so this partnership sales, so Shredi Vyavahara, so sequences and series. Okay. So this will be one chapter. Kshetra Vyavahara, geometry of planar figures. Then Khata Vyavahara, see in those days, excavation. Okay. So this is, there will be some chapter. Then there is Kuttaka, okay, linear indeterminate equations. So Varga Prakriti, quadratic indeterminate equation. So I want you to draw, I want to draw your attention to these two things, which not many of us know. So in fact, I came to know only recently, Ankapasha Vyavahara, combinatorics, okay, matrix and music, and Bhadra Ganita Vyavahara. Okay. Bhadra Ganita, have you heard? So magic squares.
They call it Kabbalah now.
See, Kabbalah in which language, I don't know.
Mathematics.
Yeah. No, that is fine. But what I am saying is, see, this has a different connotation in other civilizations. So, the magic squares was used for a different purpose in those other places. In the Indian country, they are called Bhadra Ganita. Bhadra means that will fetch you prosperity, well-being, etc. Okay. So, it is an interesting name which one finds. Okay.
They call yantras now.
Huh?
They call yantras.
Yeah, they got yantras, etc. Okay. So this Bhadra Ganita, so magic squares. So in fact, one of my colleagues, so M.D. Srinivas, made a very interesting presentation in Kerala about a month back. So I was quite astonished to know the kind of work that they have done, particularly in this Narayana Pandita's Ganita Kaumudi, which not many of us know. Okay, it is a very interesting thing. So magic squares in itself is a very interesting thing. Yes, see, in fact, if you look at this, see, this chapter has 60 rules and 17 examples. Okay. So they have plenty of examples will be there in each of these texts. Okay. So to make the student understand. Okay. So the other thing which I wanted to say was, so this is just a background to one problem which I am going to present a little later. Okay. So if you ask what is 1 plus 2 plus 3 and so on, mathematics pada, it is n into n plus 1 by 2. So this is, so this is n into n plus 1. So everybody knows, even Aryabhatta has said, okay, in 499 AD there is a shloka in which Aryabhatta gives all the three. Okay. But if I ask you, how do you find out the sums of sums? See, 1 plus 2 plus 3 and so on n, I call it as V n 1. So this suffix which you find n here refers to the number of terms in the series, and the power that you find here 1 refers to this as first order. Okay. So then, so can you make out what this notation is? So V11 means simply 1, V21 means 1 plus 2, okay? Vn1 means 1 plus 2 plus and so on up to n. So this is sums, sum of sums, you understand? So that is what they call as Vara Sankalita, okay? Sum of a series, sums of sums. So you find lot of sums here and you are summing it, okay? V2n. So this he has given value, and in general he says what is Vn to the k. So this occurs in a very practical problem. So it is not something which is very abstract, you will see the practical application of this. So in fact he says the general rule is Vnk is this. Okay. So this is what this man says, this is shloka. Ekadhika varamitaha, so padadi rupottaraha, see, so prathak ekad. So this is how it is. Padadi rupottaraha means n, n plus 1, n plus 2. Pada is a word which refers to n. Rupa uttara means rupa is 1. Why is rupa 1? What does rupa mean?
Form.
See, he has a unique form. I have a unique form. The stick has a unique form. Every being in the world has a unique form. Okay, and therefore they use the word rupa to refer to 1. Okay. So rupottaraha means increased by 1. And so this is the formula. Okay, I will not get into the details of that. So this is basically, okay, n plus k c k plus 1. So this is what is Narayana Pandita shloka. Now the problem is this. It is a cow problem. You have heard of poly cow? So this cow problem. So he says prativarsham gau sute. So every year the cow is supposed to yield a child. Prativarsham gau sute. Sute means it gives birth. Varshatritayena, the progeny of the cow, after 3 years that will start producing. Okay. Varshatritayena tarnaki tasyaha, the first cow. The first progeny of the first cow. So will start yielding after 3 years. Vidvan, so he is asking, okay, oh mathematician. Vimshati varshaihi, after 20 years, tell me what will be the number of cows. Understand? Vidvanne vimshati varshaihi, gaur ekasyascha santatim kathaya. Okay, what will be the number of cows, okay, after 20 years. So, this is a problem and this problem can be solved, okay, only if you know this. The sankalita sankalita you should know. So, how to sum the sums? Because the first cow would have we got some 20. After 3 years, the next cow would have got some, okay, a series. Okay, so that is how it is. So this is how it comes to, it will be a huge number, some 2000 and odd, okay. So this is how the problem has been solved. So this is the first generation, second generation and so on, seventh generation. So the number of years is 20, okay. So this is how we have to go and solve the problem. The other thing which I want to say is, there is something called Kshetra Vyavahara, I told you. Kshetra Vyavahara, Kshetra means, okay, floor kind of a thing. So, Vyavahara is something which you deal with. So, it means geometry is always, so you have a slate, you draw something and then you deal. So, any geometry they call it as a Kshetra Vyavahara. So, the Kshetra Vyavahara, if you want to start, first of all you have to define certain geometrical shapes clearly. And then you should start the properties of those geometrical shapes. So, they are all very nicely done in this Ganita Kaumudi. It is systematically he goes, okay. So he says, samabahu dvisamabhujam vishamam cheti tridha bhavati tribhujam. So tribhujam, when you say triangle, so you can think of equilateral triangle, you can have two sides equal, you can have angles equal. So he just classifies them, okay, equilateral, isosceles, scalene triangle. Then chaturasram, when you think of, so there are 5 types he says, okay, samabahukam, ayatam, dvisamabahu. Samabahukam means all the 4 sides are equal. Ayatam, so stretched one, visamabahu, trisamam, vishamam, and so on. Why I just want to tell you was, he systematically defines, so what are the different geometrical shapes before taking up any geometry problem. The geometry problems are very interesting. So, I just want to give you a list of problems. I will not read and explain, but I just tell you the bamboo problem. Okay. The bamboo problem is, so a bamboo was there, so there was a wind, so it just broke, so it fell down. So, how far will it go? So, where your house has to be, okay. It falls. Okay. So, it is in this bamboo problem, you just say, so where it goes and touches, etc. This is one kind of a problem. Arrow problem has to do with the arrow. So, there is an archer who is sitting an elephant. He says the elephant is some 14 foot in height. Okay. So, and then there is a warrior who is on the other side sitting here. So, he shoots an arrow so that it has to just touch the, graze the elephant's head and hit that fellow. Okay. So, now what is the angle at which this fellow has to shoot the arrow? So, what he says further is, if the other fellow starts shooting at the same time, so assume that the arrows come at the same speed, so if they go and hit, where will they hit and break? Okay. So, these are the kinds of problems which he is trying to pose here. And then this is a lotus problem. So, these are all very practical examples which everyone sees. So, there is a lotus which is this. Okay. So, the lotus is, so let us say it is about 8 inches above the surface of the water. There is a mild breeze which comes. So, lotus starts slowly dipping. Okay, it just sinks. So, then he will say, so if the lotus which was there in the, along the direction, if it sinks, so let us say at 12 inches away from that, then tell me what will be the height of the stem of the lotus. So, these are some practical problems which they give, okay. So, to make things interesting. And so, this will be interesting for everybody. There are certain problems which will be interesting for youth. So, he just says cuckoo problem. Okay, this cuckoo problem, so he says there is a pond. Okay. The pond, so is rectangular in shape and this is so much of length, this is so much of length. So, during night, okay, so one of the mates went there and the other fellow is sitting in the other corner. Okay. So, he is in one corner, he is in the diagonally opposite corner. Assume when the sun rises, so both of them suddenly wake up. Okay, they were sleeping and they remember of the other person. So, and then they start moving. They move along the banks. Okay. So, this fellow starts moving this way, that fellow will start moving that way. So, tell me where they will meet. Okay. So, that is the kind of a thought. So, samagati manam tayoho yadi ganitam vijanasi. Okay. So Karnapatha, Kokaha, Drutametya, Ratimana Militaha. Ratimana Militaha mean excited by that. Excited by looking at the other person. They start moving. But they move in such a way that the distance travelled will be shortest. So that is the problem. Okay. So this solo will travel like this, this solo will travel like this, and then they Now I have to quickly run through a certain few slides. So this is an interesting problem. So I said that they had a certain technique to handle all the infinite numbers which appear in a series. So this is an interesting thing, interesting result which I find in Aryabhatiya Bhashya. So it is not that this problem was just picked out of blue moon. So he just, this has a practical application. I will just show you where it appears. So you have a series. See, first number is 1 by 4, next number is 1 by 4 to the power 2, plus and so on, plus 1 by 4 to the power n, plus and so on, it is infinite. You can easily see that the magnitude is going to be drastically decreasing, but then, so the answer is 1 by 3. So the limiting value is 1 by 3. Now the question is, how do you know that it is 1 by 3? The contribution may be infinitesimal, but the infinitesimal contribution, how does it sum up to that? So this is the question that any mathematician encounters. First of all, where do you encounter this infinite number? That is one thing. The second thing is, if you encounter this infinite number, okay, of terms appearing, then how do you know the sum? So this is a very challenging problem. That is why the notion of limit is not a simple thing. So though people had to deal with some such things at some point of time, so it was precisely defined only in the 19th century by Cauchy. So very definition of limit comes only then. So here, this is the problem. The problem is, so Neelakantha, so he says, see, the, as I told you, the problem is to find the relation between the arc length and the chord length. Understand? So this is the problem. The problem of science is that. So this in fact gave rise to calculus in India. As I told you, they had analytical results which involved sine function, and therefore they had to find out sine function precisely, which in fact gave rise to this. So here, so they call it as, see, if you look at this, I just wanted to introduce some terms. Suppose you think of A, B, C, okay, only this section you think of. So this looks like a bow, okay, so that is why they call it as chapa. The arc is called a chapa, and BD, if you look at, so this looks like an arrow, therefore they call it a shara. You understand? So this is shara, and this is like a string of the bow, and therefore you call it as jya. Jya is string, jardha. This is how they have coined the names. Now what Neelakantha says is, if you know the shara and jya, what he means is, if you know AD and BD, will you be able to say what AB is? So this is an arc. So if you see AB, the segment is straight away Pythagorean. Pythagorean circle, Sulva Sutra, Sulva theorem. Some people have called it as Sulva theorem because it occurs in Sulva Sutra. Anyway, so but you want to find out this, okay? So for this he says, this is the approximate relation, chapa. So the arc length AB can be determined in terms of shara and jya by this relation. But how do you get 1 plus 1 by 3 here? So this is a geometrical way. If you try to construct, you can find, you have to, you will encounter with some infinite series, so which I showed you in the previous slide. Okay, so that he has given it as 1 by 3. So anyway, in general, so this is what I want to say. Katham punaha tavadeva vardhate tavad vardhate cha. The question that he asks is, if you have this series 1 by 4, so summation to the power n, okay, n going to infinity, so how do you know that it is equal to 1 by 3? So katham punaha tavadeva vardhate tavad vardhate cha. So Sanskrit is a beautiful phrase. Tavadeva means it goes only up to 1 by 3 and definitely up to 1 by 3. You can say it goes up to 1 by 3, but up to, do you know for sure that it is the other infinitesimal contributions will contribute so that it becomes exactly 1 by 3? So these are the two questions that he poses, and in fact he gives a detailed explanation for this. So one can show that this is how the proof is, so which I will skip. But I just wanted to tell you that the notion of limit, okay, so is just appearing in this statement. Okay. So this definition given by Cauchy in 1821 is somewhat akin to the question that has been posed by Nilakantha. So this infinite series, in fact, so Leibniz was highly praised for coming up with this brilliant thing. It is indeed a brilliant thing, and this has been expressed in the form of a shloka like this. See, Vyase Varidhi Nihate. Varidhi means four. So Varidhi actually means ocean, okay, a reservoir of water. So ocean. Varam Nidhihi. Var means water. Nidhihi is reservoir. So ocean represents four because it surrounds every continent. Okay, so all the four sides divide water. Therefore, they use the word ocean to refer to number four. Vyase Varidhi Nihate. Then he says Rupa Hrite divided by 1. Vyasa Sagarabhihate Trisharadi. There is a strange coincidence. Sanskrit you have 3. English also you have 3. Okay, the number 3. So 3 means 3 here. Okay. 3. Shara means 5. Shara is Bana, I told you. Can anybody guess why 5? Madana Suma. Madana Suma. So Madana means Manmatha. Okay. The Lord of Love. So this fellow can shoot 5 arrows. So all the 5. Okay, all the 5 senses.
5 senses.
Will be lost if that fellow shoots. So that is why we have the word Shara. Okay, Madana. So he is called Shara. Okay? So Shara is the word which refers to number 5. Either you have this 5-star hotels. No? Okay, so this Shara, Tri Sharadi, Vishama Sankhya Bhaktam. Okay, so 3, 5, etc. Vishama Sankhya is odd numbers. Okay, so you divide by all the odd numbers. Tri Sharadi, Vishama Sankhya Bhaktam. So Rinam Swam. Rina is negative, Swam is additive. So you do alternatively plus minus. Rinam Swam Prathak Kramat Kurya. So this is how the series, this infinite series relating the circumference and diameter, has been beautifully said by Madhava. Okay, so this is the shloka which we use that. In fact, as late as when is this book? 2007. Okay, a biography of some mysterious number. So this author, so suppose they have written 34 books on mathematics, etc. But still, there is no mention of Madhava. The point I am trying to say is, okay. So this is not much known in the West. Okay. So I would not say it is deliberately done, etc. And the point is, so this book which has been written as late as 2007, when so much has been spoken about all this, so they do not even mention. So they say that greatest mathematician, Gottfried, by 5 years. He might have done independently. I am not objecting to that. But the point is, so 3 centuries earlier, so there is something which should be known. Okay. In fact, he says, see, God is happy with odd numbers. So what figures is only odd numbers? In this series, you have only odd numbers, right? 3, 5, 7, etc. So this connects a beautiful thing, circumference and diameter. So therefore, somebody says God is happy with odd numbers.
Excuse me, is this also called primary numbers?
Huh?
Is this also primary numbers? Odd numbers are also primary numbers?
Mm-hmm. What is primary numbers? You want prime numbers, you are saying?
Prime numbers.
No, prime is okay. So the proof, I just want to give an idea of how they proved it. Saying the series is not, you just can't suddenly come up with something. So you have to have an approach. In fact, one of the reasons as to why people do not want to recognize Indian contribution is, they feel that things have been put in a very terse form, no explanation, nothing, etc. Okay? But that is how the system was. In fact, the system was verbal transmission of knowledge, not written form. So this being the case, you should have as brief as possible, you should be able to express things. And if some explanation is required, it can always be given. So the geometrical proof, I will not get into the details of that, but I just want to tell you that Neelakantha, in the Kerala work, we find a systematic way of arriving at this series. It is not a simple thing, okay? So, it is a very brilliant, and this involves the notion of infinite coming into picture. So, you have to have your infinitesimal. The moment you say infinitesimal, obviously the other thing will blow up, the numbers will blow up, okay? So, if the divisor goes on small, then the other thing will go large. So, the notion of limit, the notion of zero, the notion of infinite. Infinitesimal, infinity, infinitesimal, infinite and limit. So, all the three are sort of bundled together. If you untie, all the three will open up, okay? Otherwise, it will not. So, that is how they seem to have done. So, in fact, the notion of differentiation, etc. comes into this picture. Certain other things also came into. Incidentally, they were showing certain things. So, asymptotically, how it will go, etc. So, in fact, when this presentation was done, David Mumford was quite fascinated, okay? So, one thing I must tell you, so this, he should be close to 70, maybe, yeah. In fact, so when the lecture was given, he was the person among the audience who was so studious, so carefully listening, okay. So, he is very keen in trying to understand what the other contributions are, apart from the contribution which from Europe, so which we call as Eurocentric view. So, the other contributions are quite different, their approach was different. So, it is a fascinating thing to know how the same problem has been solved by different civilizations and what was the purpose which drove them to solve the problem. So, these are the things. In fact, one thing which I want to tell you was about this series. So, who has studied mathematics or which discipline? BSc, MSc, whatever?
No, I just gave my first
time. Oh, so, how will the series converge is the question that I wanted to ask you. So, this is a very, very slowly converging series. If you want to use this series, so you have to add something, subtract something, add something, subtract something. So, if you want to get pi value from this, okay, correct to 4 decimal, you have to take some 10,000 terms, see, or 1 lakh terms in the series. See, 1 lakh terms, in fact, I would say, so it will be one order higher. If you want to get 4 decimal places correctly, you have to count, okay, so 10 to the power of 5 terms. So, that is how the series is so badly useful, okay. So, it is not useful as a numerical estimator at all. So, it is a excruciatingly slowly converging series. So, this series, Madhava would have arrived at this series, but what is the point? He wanted to get pi value. So, if you want to get pi value correct to 8 decimal places, you just can't be counting a billion term. It is impossible, humanly impossible. So, the brilliantly he found a way. So, that is what is very interesting, but I will not be able to explain that to you, but all that I wanted to say was, with this series, so you can terminate wherever you want. You can terminate at the 50th term, you can terminate at the 20th term, so you can make an estimate of the remainder number of terms and then quickly get the pi value very accurately. I will just show you a graph. In fact, it is an interesting term. You know, Jamita means what? Have you heard? Jamita is boredom. So, he says, if you get bored by summing up the series, you can stop it anywhere, he says, okay. Yet sankhya harane, okay, you keep on adding, so you say, oh, I didn't get, okay. Nivritta hritistu, hritihi is division. Nivritta hriti means you retire. You retire from division due to boredom at whichever point, you can stop there. I will give you a solution, you just add some term, you will get the, okay, that is how he presents it. So, I will just not get into the details, but I just want to tell you the result. So, if you just consider, see, even say some 50 terms in the series, you will be able to get pi value correct to 10 to the power of 11 decimal places. Okay, this is how Madhava would have arrived at. So, just compute 50 terms in the series and then you use a certain technique which he called as Antya Samskara. Okay? Antya Samskara means after the life energy goes, whatever is done. Okay? So, similarly, your energy is gone by counting the number of terms, you do a samskara and then you get the value. So, that is how they have coined the word Antya Samskara. Okay? So anyway, so this is another thing which I want to tell you is this infinite series for sine function. So this is also beautifully given in the form of verses. So this verse actually gives you the infinite series for sine function. I will not bore you with all the explanations. So you get a series like this, which is same as this, which is the well-known expression for the sine series. Okay. And so this is. I told you initially that they have also got the derivative of sine inverse function. So I just want to tell you the context in which it comes. If you have a planetary model, so you say the planet is here, the observer is here, then so the expression for the longitude of the planet, okay, so happens to be of this form. So if you say that the longitude of this form, then if you want to find out the rate at which it moves, obviously you have to find d by dt of this, so which involves d by dt of this, and therefore they had to find out the derivative of sine inverse function. Okay, so this is just I want to tell you the context in which it comes. So this is where I am going to conclude in next 2-3 slides. So there is a tendency to deny the originality. So this is a question mark. Okay, I am not saying that. Okay. So here one of the leading mathematicians, okay, van der Waal. I just leave it to you. I want to read this. The Greeks had motive for occupying themselves with Pell's equation. The Pythagoreans wanted to find rational approximations for what we call root 2. And they found Archimedes needed approximations for root 3, and therefore he used this equation. Fine. But what is missing in the whole discussion of 4-5 pages of van der Waal is any mention of this in other civilization. Okay? So what is missing is mention of efforts made by Indian mathematicians. Van der Waal just lived, okay? So this is in 1983. It is all well known, Brahmagupta's contribution, etc., to obtain rational approximation. In fact, it's in Sulva Sutra you have this. It's a very interesting thing. Okay. So I will speak about this at some other point of time. But it's a very interesting thing. If you note this, you have 1/3 appearing. Next is 3/4. Next, if you see 3/4 × 34. One can go on like this. It's a very interesting thing, which I will not get into the details of that. So you'll get better and better rational approximation for the irrational set. Further, see, van der Waal continues. This is what is more disturbing, I would say. Why should Brahmagupta explain these methods? See, he is talking about this indeterminate equation of second order, which Brahmagupta has discussed. He is asking this question. Why should Brahmagupta explain these methods stripped of their original context in an astronomical treatise? In fact, there is no astronomical treatise, there is no mathematical treatise which was there. So it was, first part will be mathematics, all mathematics that you required will be covered in the same text. Okay? So I can find only one explanation. What is that? He followed an earlier tradition ultimately derived from Greek sources. I suppose that the Greeks were able to solve Pell's equation, so he supposes, okay, not only for d is equal to 2 and d is equal to 3, but for higher values of d by a systematic application of Euclidean algorithm, but in fact there is no such evidence. I also suppose that their methods of calculation were copied without proofs in Hindu treatises by Brahmagupta. Okay, so this is what he concludes. Brahmaspada Siddhanta. In fact, if you just see, so there is a concrete textual evidence in the Indian context. In fact, there has been a continuous effort from the Sulva Sutra period to find rational approximations to irrational sets. And another thing which I want to tell you incidentally is there was a love for large numbers here. In fact, other traditions could not think of large numbers. If you analyze carefully, so they could not think of big things. Okay, so they could not think of void also. In fact, so that is what prevented. In fact, I will just quote quotation later. So love for large numbers was there, love for algebra was there, so pressing need in astronomy was there. So this is in the Indian scenario. On the other hand, in the Greek tradition, no concrete evidence, no serious evidence. So according to him, so it was in Greek tradition, it has been transmitted, and therefore they copied. You understand? But there is no evidence for transmission also. In fact, if there are, if at all, one can say some concepts are similar in astronomy, but never in mathematics, okay? So no such evidence here. So in fact, they didn't have love for large numbers. We don't find anywhere. So no such need in astronomy also. The way they dealt with astronomy, okay? The way we dealt with astronomy is quite different from the way they dealt with astronomy. So yet there seems to be a tendency to deny originality. So to just say essence of calculus, in fact, I started with anoraniyan mahato mahiyan. Essentially, calculus is anoraniyan mahato mahiyan. Okay, so you should have a way to deal with infinitesimals, and obviously you will have to encounter infinity coming into picture. So in fact, this is what they say. Greeks could not do this little mathematical thing. They didn't have the concept of limit because they didn't believe in zero. Okay, the terms in the infinite series do not have a limit or a destination. They seem to get smaller and smaller without any particular end in sight. So in fact, he said they refuse to allow infinity. Numbers that are infinitely small and infinitely large, anywhere near the realm of numbers. This is the biggest failure in Greek mathematics, and it is the only thing that kept them from discovering calculus. So this is an observation which has been made by. So I told you, see, this Charles Cephe is a fellow. The book name is Zero: The Biography of a Dangerous Idea. Okay, so this is an interesting thing to read. That is all concluding remarks. So what we found is, okay, so far I have discussed a few things, and the culmination of all that essentially happens to be the calculus, okay, the foundations of calculus. So the technique to deal with infinitesimal and the infinite, okay. So this is to be found in the Kerala school. As I also told you, by the Santya Samskara, so they had a certain way to handle even very slowly converging series. There is a very systematic technique, so it involves continued fraction, very interesting. Okay, that has been clearly explained by these people, and there are certain things which we need to still understand about the methodology by which they arrived at certain results, and many achievements are attributed to Madhava, who lived around 14th century. His works, okay, by a chance of luck, so if one gets it will be fantastic. So see, there are some people who are investigating on whether this transmitted from that or that transmitted from this, so for which I do not have any answer. So this is the last slide. So there is an interesting observation made by Claude Alvarez. Okay, so all history is elaborate efforts in myth making. Okay, so this may sound okay to be a very strong statement, but if one analyzes, so if you want to find out what happened in 4th century, so you will have some tidbits of information from which you have to cook something. Okay, you have to guess. So it will definitely involve some kind of a guesswork, but it has to be a clever guesswork which is substantiate, consistent with the other things. Okay, so that is why he says this. So then he says, if we must continue to live with myths, however, it is far better to choose to live with those of our own making rather than those invented by others for their own purposes. Okay. So that much at least we owe as an independent society and nation. Okay, thank you.